Good. God is good.
Amen.
This meeting is being recorded.
Amen. Thank Lord.
All right. I don't see Elder David. Or, I don't know if Elder Quentin on here today.
Actually, I'm on, Brother Brian.
Right. Oh, okay, okay, okay. Can you open us up with prayer, please?
And everyone, if you would, for just a moment, offer a word of prayer. Lord Jesus, we're grateful, Lord, for this time. Thank you for your goodness and for your mercy, Lord. Thank you for blessing the saints to begin to gather, Lord God, for the benefit, Lord, of this Sunday school lesson, Lord. We're praying that you would bless us, Lord, that you would open our understanding, Lord, as Brother Brian, Lord, imparts your word, Lord Jesus. We're praying that you would help us, oh Lord God, to hear your word, Lord Jesus, and internal, Lord, have a mind, Lord, to apply it in our life. We're grateful for that, Lord God. Open up our eyes, oh Lord, to what we hear, oh God. Give us understanding and revelation of thy word, Lord Jesus. And we're grateful for what you will do. Bless us now, Lord, for we ask in Jesus' name, we say.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
God is good. Okay, this morning, I'm going to begin out of the book of Acts. The first chapter. I'm going to begin at verse 7. I'm going to just begin there, and then y'all just kind of bear with me. All right. He said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has put in his own power, but ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the earth. And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven, as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven. And I'm going to just stop right there for a moment. Again, when we look at that first part in verse number 7, when it talks about, it's not for you to know the times of the season which the Father had put in his own power. Of course, that power is exousia, which stands for authority, all right? And then also when we get down to 8, it says, but you shall receive power, the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And that power there is dynamis, speaks to miraculous power, miracle working power as well. And of course, we know witnesses, if we do not know, it stands for a martyr, also a spectator, one to give testimony. And then we, you know, add on to it. And this testimony could also cost you your life doing the work of the Lord. So when I was reading down, and then we get, I'm going to just skip down to the 11th verse, and it said, which also said, ye men of Galilee, why you stand here gazing up in heaven, this same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall come in like manner as ye see him go into heaven. And when I got there, that word work just came across my mind, right? As if to say, why y'all standing here? He just gave you all what it is that you shall do. So why are we just standing here? It's time for us to get to work, right? And of course, I'm thinking about us as the saints, and all of these things just began to go through my mind, if you will. Just several scriptures as before I continue to move forward. And I'm just thinking about, of course, the witness piece was coming across my mind, and also being a spectator, I guess, in a sense, what came across my mind, because a lot of the work that he did, you would see them bring several accounts or something in their writings. And this is one that stuck out. I'm going to go up to Luke 24, 36 through 39, right? And it said, and this is, of course, after Jesus' resurrection. It said, and as they spake, Jesus himself stood in the midst of them and saith unto them, peace be unto you. But they were terrified, affrighted, and supposed that they had seen a spirit. And he said unto them, why are you troubled? And why do thoughts arise in your hearts? It said, behold my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Handle me and see, for spirit hath not flesh and bones as ye see me have. And the scripture that connects to that one would be in 1 John to me. And it was just talking about that when the Lord say, handle me, that's what kind of stuck out to me. It said, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have what? Handled of the word of life. So those two kind of just would just stuck out to me, just that part of being that spectator. And, you know, of course, like you said, you know, they was doing the work of the Lord, but again, a lot of the work they were doing, they were confessing the Lord, trying to bring individuals to come to the realization of course, of who Jesus or God is, not was, is. So you see that a lot through scripture, right? So again, that work piece just kept going across my mind. So I'm gonna jump down to another one. St. John chapter 14 and 12, and say, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do also. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father, right? And I think I'm gonna go to James, right? James. Yeah, I'm gonna go to James. And this one, and it's still speaking on work to me, because a lot of times when we think of the work, and I'm gonna just slow down just a little bit, a lot of times we think of work, although of course, when we, I was just talking about the miraculous working power and the things that he commissioned the apostles to do, yes, they were very well to do miraculous working power and all of those things, right? But to me, you know, the more and more my mind was just kind of going, right? In order for them to be in a position to even do the work of the Lord, first of all, they had to be right in order to do it. But also anything that they did, I believe that they had to petition the Lord, and of course he led them and guided them in anything that they would do. So to me, you would see much prayer that would take place, right? So I'm gonna just jump over to this particular one that kind of just stuck out to me as well. It's in James, right? In James chapter 5:13-16, it said, is any among you afflicted, let him pray, right? Is any merry, let him sing songs. Is any sick among you, let him call for the elders of the church, and let him pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him. And if he have committed sins, they shall be forgiven in him. So confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that you may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much, right? So again, that is still locked into me, to that miraculous working power, because first of all, you can't even begin to, or the apostles, should I say, and even us, because we have the individual to have his spirit, we should be also able to do those particular things, but it is also at the leading of the Lord, right? But again, that prayer piece is what's sticking out to me as far as most of the work that should be done by the saints, right? And I know we talk about it a lot, and I guess we're going to keep on talking about it, because that is the most vital piece of what a saint should be doing, you know, praying always is one of the things. Paul say all the time, he say, Paul is always saying, I make mention of you in my prayers continuously. He might have worded it something differently between each book that he have written, but he also said it several times. I make mention of you in my prayers always. So that is for us always to take that and use that an example and apply that what to us, right? Because we are to what? Pray. That is our main job as saints. I know we want to go about and we want to, you know, help individuals get healed and raise them from the dead. But again, in order for you to even do it in that particular sense, it's the Lord that is leading you to be able to do those particular things. And he gets the glory and he gets the honor. Because see, once we get out or put ourselves in a position and say, oh, well, the Lord is using me, right? So now it's back unto me and not unto him, because this is him. It is you doing his work, right? And we can't ultimately do his work unless we are submitting and we are basing ourselves and we're doing what it is that we need to do for him. It's the Lord that does this, not us. We are just vessels that he uses to do his work, right? But another thing, right, when I was continuing to read down, right, and we're still in the book of Acts, and so when we go down, right, I'm gonna just pick back up at the 12th verse, and I'm gonna just continue to read down. Well, I'm gonna go to 11th and read down just a little bit further, right? It say, which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you in heaven, shall come in like manner as ye have seen him go up into heaven, right? It say, then returned they unto Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is from Jerusalem, Sabbath day's journey. And when they were come in, they went up into the upper room where both Peter and James and John and Andrew, Philip, Thomas, Bartholomew, Matthew, James, the son of Alphaeus, and Simon Zelotes, and Judas, the brother of James. Watch this part. It said they all continued with one accord, what, in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brethren. Again, I just talked about how in the 11th verse, to me in my mind, he told him to go to work, right? But what is the first thing that they did, right? They went back and they got into prayer, because you can't ultimately do the work of the Lord unless you're praying unto him and he is leading and he is guiding you in whatever fashion that he would have you to go to, right? And right after that prayer, I ain't going to read all of it, but it said in those days, and Peter stood up in the midst of the disciples and said, the number of the names were about 120, right? So meaning he just got off his knees off of prayer. And the next thing he did is he began to tell them, right now, I'm going to go to 16th. Men and brethren, this scripture needs must have been fulfilled, which the Holy Ghost by the mouth of David spake concerning Judas, which was the guide of them that took Jesus, right? So again, this is right after prayer. And then he stood up and he began to speak unto them, right, and tell them what was next, right? And so to me, that all came from him just being down with the Lord and the Lord just opening up his mind, speaking to him, or whatever the case may be or what have you, right? So again, we talk about the Lord and doing his work, but again, that prayer piece is very vital unto the saints, right? That is a vital piece. And we talked about them being martyrs, if you will. And we know that several individuals, I believe, we know Stephen, of course, was a martyr, right? And you see that in the book of Acts, chapter 7, verse 60, right? When Stephen was stoned, right? And right underneath that is when you see, it says, Saul, which is Paul, was consenting unto his death, right? And we know again that Saul was another individual that the Lord used mightily to do his work, right? But again, we talked about, you know, them being martyrs and being able to do the work of God. And also Paul was also a martyr. I believe he was beheaded and all of that. And I believe you see in the book of Timothy, the second book of Timothy, is when you can see when he said, I'm now ready to be offered, right? My time of departure is at hand. That's 2 Timothy 4 and 6, right? When he was talking about his time to be offered up unto the Lord. But again, like I said, let me touch base back on that. Even by that particular time, by the time Paul is ready to be offered unto the Lord, right? We see that he also said, like I said at the beginning, is that it was much prayer that took place. He did a lot of work for the Lord, right? And everything he did to me, it was by the leading of the Lord, with certain places that he was not even allowed to go, that he wanted to go. But again, he was doing everything at the leading of the Lord. You know, the Holy Ghost forbade him not to go certain places at certain times, right? But again, we talk about the leading of the Lord and the Lord guiding him and what have you, right? And I was just, you know, just thinking about certain things. I think one other particular scripture also that stuck out in my mind, as far as us doing the work and all of those things, right? It say Matthew 24 and 46, it said, blessed is the servant whom his Lord, when he cometh, shall find him doing. Again, to me, that speaks to us being in continual prayer and work for the Lord, because he's coming back. And as far as I'm concerned, we need to be finding ourselves doing the work of the Lord. Again, I think a lot of times we get in our mind that we have to be doing this, like I said, the raising the sick and raising the dead and healing the sick, should I say, and doing all these other things. But the biggest thing for us to do is to pray, because it's the Lord. You know, we may not be able to reach or be able to go certain places, but you know, the Lord's presence reaches every single space, right? So again, I was just kind of on that, that James. So James was kind of on my mind this morning, right? And as I began to just think about that a lot this morning, right? And again, it's that prayer, it's that work, right? So I'm gonna go back over here to him, right? So and the book of James chapter 5, 13, verse 8. It say, is any among you afflicted? Let him do what? Pray. Is any among you afflicted? Hallelujah, Jesus. Say, let him pray. So again, individuals may very well have things going on in their body, and they are not revealing it unto us as saints, right? But if we are down on our knees and we're praying fervently, my Lord and my God, Jesus, unto the Lord, he can very well lead us in prayer and whom we should be praying for, even though, hallelujah, Jesus,
amen,
those individuals have not told us what is going on with them and in their body, my Lord and my God, Jesus. Amen. They don't have to reveal those things to us, because God knows all things. And if we are down in prayer, the Lord can lead us and guide us in exactly for what he wants us to pray for, my Lord and my God, Jesus. And that miraculous, my Lord and my God, that miraculous prayer, that miracle working power does not come from us. It comes from God. So when we're down on our knees and we're praying unto the Lord, some of us may not be able to get down on our knees, but we're bowing our head and we're speaking and we're talking unto the Lord. He is able to go out and do his own will. Because come on now, I ain't saying that every time that we pray for somebody, individual that we may know their sicknesses and things like that, that he's going to do it. We have to also believe and know that he does things at his own will. We want things the way that we want them, but God knows what he is going to do. He can very well be using that sickness to help somebody else that's going to go through, so they can point back to this individual. Yes, the Lord may not have healed them, but he carried them and he willed them through as they are going through. So as we look at these individuals that may have sicknesses in their bodies, my Lord and my God, Jesus, the Lord is using them as for examples for us to be able to carry on, my Lord and my God, because we are leaning on him. It is him that pushes us through. It's him that guides us through as we're going through these tough times, my Lord and my God.
Amen.
It is through him. So saints, my Lord and my God, Jesus, I don't think that I'm going to be able to emphasize this enough on today. My Lord and my God, Jesus, it is prayer, my Lord and my God, Jesus, that helps see us through. Things ain't right, things ain't looking right, my Lord and my God, Jesus, but prayer, my Lord and my God, prayer is what helps get us through. And we may sometimes, my Lord and my God, Jesus, I always bring up that song that Sister Nikki sang all the time. You don't know what else to say and you don't know what else to do. What you call on the name of Jesus, because that name, my Lord and my God, Jesus, that name alone, my Lord, is everything.
Hallelujah. Amen.
angle up into that name, because I may have cancer, and I, Lord willing, I don't, but I'm using me as an example of an individual that may have it, and I can't say to the Lord, Lord, heal me of this cancer, and my mind is just all boggled up, and I just can't get it right. But what I can say is I can
catch
say, I can say, Jesus, Lord, help Jesus. Me, Lord. I can say, yes, Jesus, I don't catch know what is going on, but
yes.
you do.
Yes.
And Lord, I'm asking you to strengthen my body.
Amen.
So you can help see
Amen.
Through. That is
Amen.
What we are to do, Lord. Huh? Come on now. That is what Great. We are to do, since we are to position. I'm sorry, petition. Thank position. I got excuse. Let that bell pause. Things ain't coming
all
out right.
right
all the time.
All right.
to petition the Lord, not position. But hold up now. We also need to be in position, my Lord and my God,
all right,
to
man.
Position. To be in position to be able to be, petition the Lord for what it is that we need. We have to be in that correct headspace, my Lord and my God. He can't
Thank
use you
God.
Properly if you don't have the correct headspace. You know what I mean? You can't do what it is that he needs you to do if you are not righteous. Come on now, because he talked about yeah. the righteous prayer of a righteous man availeth much. If you ain't righteous, that is right with God, then your prayers ain't reaching his throne room. Come on
Thank
now. Huh? If the saint is to do the will of the Lord, you got to be right with him. Come on down. You can't rightly be used by the Lord if you ain't right with him. Come on now, righteous. You can't be that way with him. Come on now. So if it's anything that you need to get up out of you that we don't know nothing about, it's between you and Jesus. Like I just said, calling that name. Jesus, I don't know what it is that I got going on that ain't right with me. Well, man, it just seems like my prayers ain't reaching past the ceiling. Come on now. They ain't reached past God. The ceiling, Lord. It's something that ain't right with me. It's something that I got to get right that I can be able to reach the very throne of God. Because see, that is a gift, huh? That is a gift for us to be able to do, to be able to enter into his very throne room, right? That is, man, I can't put into words, or I'm actually doing a blank for what I really want to be a privilege. There it is.
Thank
it's
you, Lord Jesus.
It's a privilege to be able to enter in the Lord's presence and to be able to help pray for another individual.
Thank
that
you,
is
Lord.
A privilege,
yes.
you know, and I think we take it for granted sometimes, us as individuals that got the Spirit of God, that we take it for granted of what we have. Come on now. I'm gonna raise my hand because I know I'm one of them. You know, it's certain things within me that, hey man, you know what, hey, I ain't perfect, man. I don't think none of us on here claim to be, but those things that we have that we could very well be tripping us up, we need to pray to the Lord that he get us out of them. Come on now, because we talking about that prayer. Huh? And we praying that these prayers go beyond that ceiling. Huh? So what is it? Come on now, Lord. I want to be able to do this for you. Excuse me. Because it ain't about us. It's about the other individuals, right? So if we praying for everyone else, those individuals are praying for us, right? So what it is that's holding us down or holding us back, you know, as well as us praying for ourselves, these individuals are compiling those prayers on top so that they're able to break that chain, right? Because it's something that's holding us back. And I don't think that we realize the magnitude of what prayer can really do, right? I think a lot of times we wake up, we hit every service, right? We hit the Tuesday Bible study, right? We even hit Monday and Wednesday noonday prayers, right? We may even do those. We come in on Sunday, we, you know, thank the Lord for waking me up, and I come in here and, you know, I join in the service, I clap my hands and I give them, you know, my hallelujahs and all that, right? Come on now. But what are we really doing? Is our time, come on now, is our mind, if you will, is it fixed on the Lord? Is we doing what it Thank is that he is calling for us to do as individuals? They're supposed to be what? The children, my Lord and my God, of God. What are we doing? Huh? What are we doing, right? I just want to, I'm going to jump back over here, and I'm probably come back to James, but I was just I'm reading, right? And we get over to back in the Acts, and back in Acts, y'all. And you get down to that second, and Cole, we're still talking about that prayer, right? You get over to the second chapter, right? It said, when the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. I'm going to stop right there for a second. They were praying. They were praying. And I know we heard about this before, but look at it, man. It said, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind. It filled all the house where they were what? Sitting, right? And we're talking 120 people at this particular time, right? And they all were filled, my Lord and my God, Jesus, with the Holy Ghost. Again, they had just seen Jesus ascended to heaven. The two men in white apparel, basically, in my talk, why you standing here? Go to work. So they began to pray the very first thing that they did. And guess what? They continued to pray because now is the day of Pentecost, right? So and when you continue to read further, and I'm going to kind of skip through this, right? So once they received the Holy Ghost, they began to speak in other tongues that the Spirit of God gave them utterance, right? But these are all the men that heard them speak that were at Jerusalem, right? And you can read this account for yourself, right? And I think it picked up in the 9th verse when it began to speak of all the people that were in that particular place, right? And then when we continue to go down, right, I'm going to pick up at the 14th verse, right? It said, but Peter, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice and said unto them, ye men of Judea and all ye that dwell at Jerusalem, be this known unto you and hearken to my words. For these men are not drunken as ye suppose, seeing it is but the 3rd hour of the day. Come on now, what I'm getting at is that it's 9 a.m. and they were praying, right? Amen. It was 9 a.m. and they were praying, right? Because all this kicked off. Come on now. It was noise abroad from them praying in the upper room, right? On the day of Pentecost, right? So that 9 a.m., right? The 3rd hour of the day will be 9 a.m., right? And I'm going to jump over to the 3rd. Come on now, because we still talk about the witnesses and doing the work of God, right? I'm going to jump over to the 3rd chapter now, right? It said, in the very first verse, it said, now Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the 9th hour, right? That would be 3 p.m., right? My Lord and my God. Now, we know for a fact that we got 9 a.m. and we got noonday prayer from out the Bible, right? And then we also see them going up at the 9th hour, which would be 3 p.m., right? My Lord and my God.
Yeah.
Huh? So that's 9, 12, and 3. Come on now. That seems like every 3 hours. Come on now. And I ain't talking about the other time that they talking unto the Lord as they working or doing whatever they doing, but they had set aside time to make sure, come on now, that I get into this prayer with my Lord and my God. Come on now. If they felt the need, my Lord and my God, Jesus, to pray unto the Lord continuously, what about you and I? Come on now. And we know that their day was considered a 12-hour time span. It was from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. And my Lord and my God, I'm going to take it a step further. Now watch this now. Come on now. We know they played it now because Peter just said it. We know about noonday prayer because I ain't found it, but it's in here. Trust me, it is. And we see again at the 9th hour at 3 p.m. Now, I don't know. I'm just one to believe that when they open up their eyes at 6 a.m. or when they started, should I say, at 6 a.m., we're going to say that they prayed then at that time too. And right at the end of the day, come on now, because you got to thank the Lord for the day that you just had throughout your day. I ain't saying they went to sleep at that particular time, but they were getting ready to wind up their day from 6 a.m. to 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. to 3 p.m. and 6 p.m. Come on now. I'm going to say, come on now, that they had to been praying unto the Lord. Come on now. I ain't saying that it had to be one of them long and drawn out prayers. Come on now, that they had to been laying everything down on the line and all those things. It's something simple as, come on, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Heal this one, Jesus. I thank you for the day, my Lord and my God. I thank you for waking me on this morning. Come on now. I ain't saying that we got to have those long and drawn out prayers. Come on now. You could do that throughout the day. Come on.
Amen. Amen.
All day long. Come on, that's what I see right here all day long. Come on now, I see every 3 hours, but yes. I am one to believe that this right here had to be going on in between those hours from 6 and 9. Come on now. Amen. In between the hours of 9 and 12, in between the hours of 12 and 3, in between the hours of 3 and 6. Come on now. Amen. All day, that was praying unto the Lord. That was what the job was of the saints. Come on now. And these individuals, come on now. This is what they were doing. And again, we talked about them being witnesses, and we talk about them doing miraculous work and power. And then we're going to jump down for a second now. Second verse, chapter 3. And a certain man lame from his mother's womb was carried, whom they laid daily, come on now, at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of them to enter into the temple. Come on now. Who seen Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked an alms. And Peter, fastening his eyes upon with John, said, look on us. And he gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something of them. Then Peter said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, come on now, give I thee in the name of Jesus Christ, my Lord and my God. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. Come on now. And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up. And immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength, right? He said, and he leaping up stood and walked and entered with them, come on now, because they still went into prayer now, went with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising who? God. He was still praising God. Now, come on now, what I'm going to say is, come on, they was on their way to prayer. Come on now.
Thank God.
They was already thinking about the Lord. Come on now. What they were probably getting ready to say to the Lord was already on their mind. But this man was laid at this gate daily. Come on now. So the individuals, as they walked past him every day, he might have been asking for alms, silver and gold. And they very well may have got something this day, got something the other day. But I'm going to tell you what, it is hard for me to believe that the individuals, every day that they walked past them, all they did was gave them silver and gold. Come on now. Well, as they went into that temple, I have to believe, come on now, that they were praying that the Lord touched them. Come on now. They had to be praying something. They may not have very well said, raise them up, Lord. But he was on their mind as they was going down into the temple to pray. And on this particular day, this is the day that the Lord had made. Day that the Lord had made for him. Come on now. For him to still get the glory and for him to still get the honor. Come on now. Peter and John, silver and gold have I none, but such as I do have, this Holy Ghost that I do have, that I have down in me, that is guiding me and leading me right now, such as I have down in me, is telling me to tell you, rise up, hold my hand and get up, and your feet and your ankle bones, come on now, shall get strength. So now you can jump up and you can rise and you can walk and you can walk right in with me. Now you can thank your Lord and your God in the temple with me. Come on now. Now you can thank him right along with me. You may have been very well thanking him out in the street. Now you can come on in. Hallelujah, Jesus. Come on in with me. Sup with me. The Lord wants your time. So come on in to his presence. Jesus. Come on now. Come on now.
Amen, Jesus.
You know all I can think about at that particular time is that table of incense, because it represents prayer.
Mm-hmm.
Continuously going up. So what were they doing, Peter and John, all day long? To me and my mind, they are doing the will and the work of the Lord. They are praying all day. They are helping individuals, because you see all through the book of Acts. Come on now. We can probably go on and on and on about everything that we witnessed inside of here, right? Come on now. They always talked about being witnesses for the Lord. Come on now. He told them they was going to be their witness. He knew that they knew that they was going to be martyred, right? Even told Peter, you know, when you get old, and I'm paraphrasing, come on now, you're going to be taking other places that you ain't going to be able to control yourself, basically, in a sense. Basically, you're going to be martyred. right?
Thank you, Lord.
Huh? That's me paraphrasing now. Y'all just bear with me now. But also, I believe it was even John even asked about, or Peter even asked about John, should I say, well, what's going to happen to him? And the Lord said, well, what concern of that is yours? I may have very well had him tarry. Yeah. Now, we know he did, huh? It's where he wrote the book of Revelation, right? The island of Patmos, if I'm not mistaken. So the Lord does things the way he want to do them. But what my Lord and my God, what I just got from that is, mind your business, Peter. You asking me about what's going to happen to him. You need to be worried about what's happening to you. I just told you what I was going to do with you, and you worry about what's good for somebody else's fate. Come on now. Keep your eyes on your own prize. Come on now. Keep your eyes on what it is that the Lord got for you to do. You worry about how he blessing so-and-so and how he doing this for so-and-so. But you need to be worried about Brian. Come on now. You ain't got to be worried about turning your head to the right or to the left. You worried about everything else the Lord is doing for somebody else. You wonder why he ain't blessing you and why he ain't doing these particular things for you.
Lord.
Trust me, he is blessing you. Did he wake you up that morning? Huh?
Amen.
Did he place your feet on solid ground? Come on now. Did he do all those things for you? See, we got to thank the Lord for those little things. Come on now. We worried about those big conglomerate things. We want the money, the house, and the car. That's the main thing we always want. Come on now. We always asking the Lord for those things. Lord, I just want this big old house. Lord, I need to have it. For what? Huh? I ain't saying don't strive to get them, but what I'm saying is, why are you constantly asking the Lord, can he do those particular things for you? Why don't you ask the Lord, what can I do for you? Huh? Lord, why am I here? Huh? I need to be a help unto you. Come on now. He said, because now I go unto the Father, and greater work shall you do. And he's talking about numerically. Come on now. Now, how are you going to do a greater work for him? Because see, that would involve you being able to help him. Come on now. That would involve you being able to help them. But if you constantly praying for yourself and constantly worried about yourself, constantly worried about these houses and the cars and the job and all these things, all that monetary stuff, huh?
Thank you.
If you're worried about that, how you gonna do something for him?
Amen.
If you're worried about those things, how are you gonna do something for him? Our job is to do what it is that he called us to do.
Thank you.
The number one job as a saint, as a child of God, huh? Is to pray. That is your number one job.
Thank you.
Every time you're saying, I want to go out and I want to go feed the homeless, there ain't nothing wrong with that. Come on now, don't get it twisted. That ain't what I'm saying. Do it at the leading of the Lord. Because see, once you pray it to him, then he can tell you exactly where to go to, who, because it may be an individual at this particular time that very well have been praying and needing something from the Lord. And guess what? If you're constantly going out doing your own will and your own accord, then you're going to miss out from what the Lord is telling you to do. Because you're trying to build up that own flesh and bless yourself on the back about what it is that you are doing, because it ain't about you. This work is all about Jesus. So we get outside of ourselves and focus our attention. Come on now, our attention and all these things onto the Lord, then we could very well be a help. Come on now, unto the Lord. Come on now, be a help unto the Lord. Come on now. I think it was even, and I'm paraphrasing here, when he was talking about he did. Basically, help out the individual that is poor. He lendeth unto God.
He doeth
these particular things to help the individual that have not. Lendeth. Come on now. Can you imagine lending something to Jesus? Come on now. Come on now. You lend this unto the Lord. So that's what he's gonna give back to you now. And I ain't saying run out there and go hurry up and go find the next person you see on the street that needs something. Come on, Lord, you see I just gave it to him. Come on, what you gonna give back to me? Come on now. I ain't saying that. What I'm saying is do it with the correct heart, huh? Do it with the correct mindset, because it is truly people that is in more need of you. Come on now. They truly don't have I ain't gonna say it now, man. They don't have a window to throw it out of. Y'all know the other piece, huh?
Thank you, Lord.
Y'all know the other piece. But what I'm saying is they don't have a place to lay their head.
Thank you, Lord.
Right? They don't have a place to, they can't even go and get food. They at the shelters, and they very well got in line late, and they were not able to get a meal on that particular day. I think the biggest thing that for us as individuals is that we focus on, I want to be able to do this for the Lord, but it is him that does the leading. We got to focus on that, right?
Thank you, Mom.
We got to focus on that. And again, the biggest thing for me is for us to understand that he's coming back. Yes. And we have to be finding ourselves working. And that working piece, of course, is if you can't physically go out, your mouth work, open it up. You understand what I'm saying? Open it up. Pray for these other individuals or the other individuals that are able to go out. You're praying for them as they go out.
Thank you, Lord.
Right? As they continuously do a work for unto the Lord. That is what we need to do as that body of Christ, right? So again, we're just looking, I was just looking through here and it was just several things that kind of stood out, right? And that man, you know, that was laid at that gate again, like I said, he was laid there daily. Peter and John, again, daily. We see they're going up to the hour of prayer at 3 p.m. And this particular day was a day that the Lord decided to heal this man. Again, to me, the emphasis on prayer. They ain't worried about, they ain't thinking about, Peter ain't worried about, or John, should I say, but neither one of them are worried about the tail end of what it is of their life, should I say. Come on now. They ain't worried about that tail end of their life, right? What are they doing? They just here doing the will of the Lord, right? And I'm going to jump real quick. I'm going to do Book of Revelations 22 and 12. It said, and behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give every man according as his work shall be. He got a reward for you. Come on now. He said, behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me. Come on now. He coming back. We say it, we know it, or we claim to know it, but he is coming back, and he want to find you doing your job, right? He said, and my reward is with me to give every man, come on now, according as his work shall be. Come on now.
Amen.
Come on now. Every woman, man, boy, girl, that is in my Lord and my God, Jesus Christ, have something to do. Petitioning for. What is it, Lord, that you will have for me to do unto thee? What is it, Lord God Jesus, that I can do to help assist another individual in your work? Come on now. Come on now. Yeah. It's a lot of work. And I'm going to jump off, you know, this for just one quick second. I'm going to just talk about here at 810. It's a lot of work to be done in here. Brothers, sisters, we see, you know, our bishop working tirelessly. I'm jumping on or hopping on Elder Johnny. My mind just kind of went there. So y'all forget. Well, don't forgive me. No, come help do the work. We show up for service just like everybody else. He in here tirelessly doing the work or helping to get everything in order for us. Come on now. We need individuals that's back there on those switchboards and everything else that's going on back there. So he ain't back there. Come on now. We know that he gonna go back there because you ain't stopping, Bishop. Come on now. But what I'm saying is, where is the help? Where is the individual? Because see, that's your help. That's your peace. That's your help part. That is that piece that you're to help. Come on now. And I'm going to pray, my Lord and my God, Jesus, that the Lord sent help, right? Because guess what? The individuals, y'all ain't got to come in here and help. He'll raise somebody up and send somebody else in here to do what it is that we want. Huh? He'll send somebody else right in here to do what it is that you're supposed to be doing. Come on, man. If this is your church, this is your home, this is what you claim that you want to worship at, why are we, come on now, not doing more to help out the man of God?
Amen.
Over here leading the flock, huh? He got enough on his plate with studying this word to give us food from on high. Come on now. He got enough already to be worried about. Come on, because this ain't no easy job now. Come on. This little mediocre part that I'm doing right now. Come on now. I may be bringing it down a little bit, but the little part that I do, that I'm able to do and to help. Come on. This ain't nothing compared to what he got to do.
Thank you, Jesus.
This is my little piece to be able to help him out. But what about the other individuals that come in here all week long, see water in the back, they need that, they need this, that, the third. Huh? But he running out making sure everything go on. Come on now. Where's the help at? This is the same church that you come to. Come on now. Where the help at? Huh? Come on now. We got to do better, man. We got to do better than what we doing right now. Huh? Come on now. This is the Lord's house. Come on now. We want something from Jesus. But we ain't doing nothing for Jesus, huh? I want something from you, Jesus. But hold up, do that mean I gotta do something for you? Come on now. Yeah, it means you gotta do something for him. This is still his word. So what you need to do is come on, hey, Lord, Bishop, what can I help do? Huh? Go ahead. Be a help. Come on now. And pray. But the first thing you do, then go ask him. Come on now. Because hold up, man. If you stay down there long enough, the Lord could very well tell you before you even got to ask him. Come on now. When that way, when you see something that need to be done, come on now. And I'm talking about everybody now. When you see something that need to be done, you just step right in and do it. You ain't got to go ask him or Sopo or somebody else to ask them what needs to be done. You're going to be able to see it for yourself, because if you're in tune to your church and you're in tune to what it is that you need to come to, well, we all come to worship the Lord now, God. Come on now. If we're in tune to that, then all of us going to be able to step in and just do what needs to be done. Come on now. And I ain't got to ask what needs to be done. Huh? We're going to step in and do so, because it's, and then come on, and that goes to the body. Huh? Ain't no different. When you see something needs to be done outside of the body, come on now. You see the elderly women need help getting out their car. Get out. Come on. Walk out the door and help them now. Those are little things. Whether you believe it or not, that is still a help. A help to that individual, and it's a help unto the Lord. Come on now. Come on. Get our minds off of ourselves and onto this Lord and this God that we say. Come on now. I always got to, that we claim. We claim we serve him. We claim he this. We claim. That's the key word I keep saying. We claim it. It ain't the truth. Huh? It ain't the truth. So to me, in my mind, if you truly want to be a help unto the Lord, get down on them knees. Huh? Bow that head down. We talking all day now. Come on now. All day long. You could, look, man, I drive a bus. And while I'm at work, I'm praying to the Lord all day long. Lord, just help me. Lord, what is it? What is it, Lord? Lord, I'm just talking. Come on now. If I can't say nothing else, I'm saying Jesus. It's definitely hallelujah. I'm giving him the highest praise, because guess what? He gave me the job that I can even get up and go to. Come on now. Huh? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for waking me up. Thank you for getting me here safely. Thank you for getting me here on time. Lord, while I'm here, Lord, don't let me have accidents and things of that nature. Come on, man. I pray before I pull my bus off my lap every morning. Huh? Because it is by him that I'm able to get there. It is by him that I'm not able to get in any accidents or moving violations and so forth, right? People falling down on my bus and all these things. Come on, I ain't trying to make everything about me, but I'm still giving everything back unto him even right now. I'm using myself as an example to tell you and show you what it is that I do. Come on now, so that you can use what I'm doing as an example to apply it to your very life. Come on now. Talk to him now. It ain't just when you end your day and you ready to lay down and now you thanking him for that he helped you make it throughout the day. Huh? It ain't when you get ready to close your eyes. It's all day long. Get a Lord his just due. Huh? He woke you up. He took you through the day. And all day long, you ain't saying nothing to him just when I get home. Man, I thank you for helping me get through the day to day, Lord. That's it. That's the best you can do. And that's probably all you saying too. that's probably all you saying. Lord, I thank you for helping me make it through the day. Help me wake up again and do it again. Amen. Come on. That's all you got for him. He woke you up. He started you on your way. And all you got is that throughout all of the things. Huh? Come on. The danger scene and unseen that he kept you from all day long. That very car that could have came up and sideswiped you and took your life that you know nothing about. And the best that you can offer unto your Lord is, thank you for letting me make it through the day. Help me wake up the next day and do it again. That's all we got. Huh? Come on now. Is that all we got to offer unto our Lord and to our God? The one to put food on your table, clothes on your back, a roof over your head, and the best that you can give him. Come on now. It says, give the Lord our very best. And that is the best that you can come up with. Come on now. I think you better go back and reevaluate. Come on now. What it is that you say. Come on. That you got. Because we're talking about saints that are going through the whole entire day and laying out these lame prayers. That's the best you got. Huh? Come on now, you better go back and reevaluate what it is that you say you have. Huh? Come on now. The Lord wants your very best. He gave you his best. He laid his life on the line for you. Come on now. He did all that. He also gave you his spirit, my Lord and my God, Jesus, so you can do what? So you can spend eternal life with him. As long as you live right, as long as you doing right. Now he gave you his very best, and all we got is, thank you, Jesus. Help me do it again tomorrow. Come on now. Huh? My he Lord. Laid his life on the line for you and I. They stretch and wag and they hung them high. And the best we got, come on now. That's it. Come on now. That's all you got, huh? Man, listen, man. And I ain't saying that you're supposed to be able to make it to every single noonday or every single first and third Wednesday. I ain't saying you have to make it. Come on now. But it should be a priority. It should be something that's on your mind. Come on. You very well may not be able to make it to noonday prayer because of the type of job that you have. But I'm quite sure a lot of us, come on now, are off our jobs by 7:30 p.m. And I understand that we got children because that's myself. I'm going to speak for me now. I know a lot of times I'm not able to be in those particular prayers to join in physically, but my mind, it's on my mind, huh? Right. Come on now, come on now. And sometimes I just leave, man. He may be very well in certain practices and so forth and so on, man. I'm leaving, huh? We got to rotate this, Ma. And Mommy, Keisha, stand in. I got to go. Somebody got to pray for the family, man. Come on now.
Thank you, Jesus.
Huh? Somebody got to go before the Lord for us, huh? If I'm constantly at all the practices and so forth and so on, when am I going to give him my time? Huh? You ain't about to bombard me with all these activities. And you mean to tell me I can't get no time to Jesus? It don't work like that for me. Huh? Come on, don't work like that for me. And it shouldn't work like that for you. Because guess what? And I ain't saying that our children and we got life, right? Life is going to happen, right? And I ain't saying that we very well may not have things that could prevent us from being in these specific location at a specific time. I'm not saying that. But if we make an effort, come on now. Bishop always saying, I don't care if it's 5 minutes. That means that 5 minutes that you had that was free, you peaked. Then to say hallelujah, Jesus. Lord, I thank you, Jesus. You stepped up for 5 whole minutes to get it, Lord. That, but guess what? He can honor that 5 minutes, huh? Because that was the time that you made sure. Come on, man, maybe your lunch break. Huh? You can eat later. Come on now. I think a lot of man, it's my lunch break. I ain't jumping on that, Joan. I ain't doing that. It's 12 o'clock. I got to eat. Yeah, you do you, huh? Well, who gave you that food? That you claim it, that you got to go eat, huh? Can he get out of your 30 minutes? Can he have 15? Can he have 20? And you still got time to scarf down your lunch and hop back and do whatever it is you need to do. It don't take all that time to eat a sandwich. Come on now. If that's the case, don't go to work with spaghetti and all these things then. Go on those particular days, make yourself something slight, something small. Grab a piece of fruit or something, huh? Some of us need to. I'm speaking for myself sometimes. Come on now. Sometimes all you need is a piece of fruit anyway. You don't need all that anyway, huh? Come on now, grab yourself a piece of fruit and still give your time unto the Lord. Come on now. I'm just thinking of other ways that we are able to come together to be a help unto the Lord. Because the number one job out of everything that we got to do in this entire life, come on now, is to pray. That is what it is. The entire job of the entire body of Christ is to pray. That is what we are to do. So let that sink in. Let that get down into your core. Lord, what do I need to pray for today? Lord, lead me in what it is that you will have for me to pray for and whom I will have to pray for. But what you can start it out doing is giving the Lord thanks. And that's what I said at the beginning of this. So y'all forgive me that I did not do that because our bishop has set an example for what it is that we need to be doing when we come in the presence before the Lord. Huh? You give him thanks. First of all, that is what we do. We give him thanks for what it is. And then we can go in. Come on now. And I ain't saying go in to ask. Then you go automatically. Thank you, Lord. Now I can ask. No. No, it ain't going in now immediately to go ask. It's going in now. What would you have for me to do? And that is to pray. And that is to pray. And that is to pray some more. I think we need to really get that down in our core because we can't move forward. Come on now. Well, Lord, I just can't move beyond this.
Thank you, Lord.
Because you are constantly praying for yourself. And you're not praying for the body. You're not praying for the other individuals that the Lord placed on your mind. Huh?
Thank you.
Trust me, he placing individuals on your mind. Huh? Huh? Said the Lord make of intercession. Or who you should even pray for? Come on now. He knows all and he is all. Like I just said, the greater work shall we do because he going to the Father.
Thank you.
Now, how you going to do the work for the Lord? You ain't even praying. Huh? You can't do a greater work for him, huh? If you ain't praying, huh? He showed us in the Garden of Gethsemane. Praying. Huh? It's not just in the times of need. The last times we're going through, oh man, I better get to praying now. No. What about when things are going good?
Amen.
We want to only petition the Lord when things ain't going our way. He is more than just I think Bishop used the analogy of the aspirin bottle that we're going to take out the cabinet. Now, hold up now. I got a headache. Now, let me go get it. Let me go to the Lord now. No. See? What about before then? Huh? Come on now. See, to me, you all are always going before the Lord and you're constantly praying for other individuals and things of that nature and giving the Lord your time. Right? I think Bishop talk about that providence of God. Right? So now you ain't necessarily got to go directly and keep asking him to do these certain things because he already knows what he's going to do anyway. Huh?
Thank you.
He know what he's going to do. You know? So what is our job today, Saints? Our job is to pray. Like I said, Paul is, he said on numerous occasions, I make mention of you where in my prayers. He may not very well have been able to go to certain places, or he was very well sending letters back to check up on individuals or teaching them or showing them how to worship the Lord or help build them up so that they could be a better position to be able part of the body and a help for the Lord. But what he said almost all the time within the first few verses of every letter, I make mention of you in my prayers always.
Amen.
That is what he did. And that to me is an example, because if we read in this and we're studying this, that piece has to stick out to us. I make mention of you always in my prayers. Huh? That is what we need to be doing amongst the saints and amongst our fellow brethren, our fellow sisters. I make mention of you always. Come on now, of you in my prayers. My Lord and my God, I make mention of you, Tasha. I make mention of you, Linda. My Lord and my God, Jesus. Estelle, Ella, I'm looking at the names at the top of my screen. Sister Patricia's commenting. Elder James just commented. I make mention of all of you in my prayers. Come on now. It's the body. Everybody at 8:10. See, I'll bring it all into one space. Everybody in the 8:10. Then I may go off and call individual names. Come on now. But it ain't just about individuals that's just in here. Huh? We bring it. Come on, Mildred. I see you now. God is good. Hallelujah, Jesus. The Lord, what we do is, I think a lot of times, because we go in these specific churches, we always got a lot of times is that we pray for individuals that we know directly, that we see and what we know. Come on, it is so much deeper and it's so much wider than that. Come on, this body of Christ extends across the whole entire world. Get out of just your church. Step outside of it. Come on now. This work of God is outside of the four walls that you attend. Step outside. Come on now. Go down the streets. Begin to talk to individuals. Hey, how you doing? Come on now. I ain't saying walk up to them and ask them, what can I pray for? But come on, man, make yourself known.
Yes.
Be a part of the body. It ain't just in these four walls. Get out of it. That's the state of mind that we got. And I spoke on it earlier. All we do is we come in and we say hallelujah, sing our songs, and I see you next week. That's just like a TV show. Same bat channel, same bat place at the same time next week. That's what they did on TV shows. And that's what we carry the church as. It's like a TV show. Huh? I can't wait to see y'all next week. Come on now. You ain't talking to your brothers and sisters throughout the week. You ain't praying for your brothers and sisters throughout the week. What are we doing? Huh? We need to be an example, huh, of what Christ did and these apostles did. Come on now. When you read further in the book of Acts in the second chapter, I believe around the 41st verse, is that they're talking about as they followed in the apostles' doctrine. Huh? And what were they doing? They were following Jesus. Huh? They were following the Lord. And if we following the apostles' doctrine and we what you call apostolic, come on now. And if we're doing those things, then we should very well be doing the examples that we've seen them do. Huh? So if they praying, then we praying. If they healing, then we healing. Everything that we need to be doing, we need to be doing at the leading of the Lord. Huh? Get your mind on Jesus. Huh? Get your mind on Jesus and out of what it is that he can bless you with. Huh? Get your mind on him, saints. Huh? My Lord and my God,
He is able to do all things. Come on now. Oh, okay. But we have to trust him. We got to believe in him. And we have to allow him. That's the biggest kicker. We got to allow him to have his way in this body that he possessed. Because if we got the spirit of God down on the inside of this body, come on now. Paul even talking about, come on, man. He ain't care about this. Huh? Huh? It is something beyond this life. We are so stuck on right now. We're so stuck on this earth. Come on now.
Thank you, Jesus.
Supposed to be doing the will of the Lord and moving beyond, we know that, come on now, ain't none of us staying right here forever. We already got somewhere that we're supposed to be. Huh?
Thank you, Father.
Say this ain't my home. Huh? I got a better place beyond this, but what our job is to do is to be working until he come back. He said, find yourself working. Come on now. So by the time that he comes back, come on now. That is part of that. Well done, my good and faithful servant. Because you're serving. A servant is to serve. So if you're praying and you're doing the will of the Lord, then you can hear. Well done.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
Tell it, brother.
My Lord and my God. I thank you all in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Praise him.
Amen.
Praise the Lord, everyone. The Lord bless you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Let's give the Lord a hand praise.